Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadok coming at you through the Spirit of the Most High in Christ. For the record, I would like to reserve my right that's given to me by the Creator, my God-given right. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. This is for educational, informational, and entertainment purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney, if you can find one, then please be advised. I wanted to talk to you about the procedures of a lawsuit. I'll go over that briefly, but first, I know that many people in this day and age are suffering economical hardship. And it's all a plot of your government. It's all part of the de facto. They intend to exacerbate tensions. They want you to resort to rioting in the street so they could justify engaging a police state. So you be very careful on your actions and what you do. There is a remedy, and the remedy is given through the Heavenly Father. He's enlightening certain people with certain amount of knowledge to actually bring a remedy and some relief to all of this madness. Now, this de facto that we the people actually gave the power to actually has, you know, set up what is known as a central bank. They wanted to set up a central bank so that they don't have you printing your own money. They can't have that. They said, we can't have these people printing their own money. So this guy, Alexander Hamilton, wanted to establish a central bank. And he did. He established it, but the contract expired. So he went back and he reestablished it again. And the contract expired. So he reestablished it a third time. And, you know, they bought it back. And Andrew Jackson said that, hey, you guys are a den of vipers. You guys are a den of vipers. So he moved to destroy and kill the central bank. Andrew Jackson did that. He called them a den of vipers. And that's what they are. They have that spirit. They have that deceit. Making a slithering path everywhere that they go. Crawling in a crooked path. Using language of legalese. Language that causes confusion in the masses. Language that actually gets you to consent to something that you would not have otherwise. So Andrew Jackson said that you are a den of vipers, and he killed the central bank for a while. But then, in 1913, they came back. And they came back as what? They came back as the Federal Reserve, which is not federal, by the way. And the Federal Reserve, brothers and sisters, basically print money out of thin air. They print money that they don't have. They could not have you printing the money. So the de facto devised this scheme. The United States, which is a corporation. It's a corporation. It's a business, brothers and sisters. The United States is not a country for entertainment purposes. It's a corporation. It's a business. So they came back as the Federal Reserve. Now, we the people give Congress power to print money, to coin money. But what did Congress do? In turn, they took that power and they gave it to the Federal Reserve. So now in turn, the Federal Reserve actually has Congress borrowing what is known as money from it, which is actually unconstitutional. The Federal Reserve should not be able to print money because we the people did not give the Federal Reserve the power to print money. We gave that to Congress, but the de facto deceived you, and now they have the Federal Reserve printing money out of thin air, and Congress is actually borrowing money from the Federal Reserve. Deceived again. And this is a clique of criminals, and this is why I call them a clique of criminals. That's treason, brothers and sisters. You didn't give the Federal Reserve the power to coin money. So, and to those of you that come here and you ridicule and you make mockery and you offer little bits and pieces and pretend that you're extremely knowledgeable. If you're actually not here to help someone, then shalom, have a nice day. Move on. Don't come here to debate. I'm not... This is not an open forum for debate. This is trying to entertain you with something that actually could be essentially useful in your everyday life. Because no matter what you do in this life, it involves a contract. Every day you deal with contracts. And many of you, you want something for nothing. You've always been like that. That's why you love the welfare system. But welfare spelled backwards is farewell. So farewell to many of you. But well, you're not going to fare. So in this, the universal law, brothers and sisters, is quid pro quo. That's the universal law. The universal law is quid pro quo. That's the universal law. Quid pro quo. That's the universal law. Meaning, in order to get something, in order to exhale, you must first. In order to inhale, you must first exhale. It's something for something. It's never something for nothing. With that being said, let's get to my topic. I just wanted to put that out there. So the universal law is basically quid pro quo. Quid quo quo. Quid quo pro. That's Latin, meaning something for something. So stop thinking that you're going to get something for nothing. Oh, you're giving us bits and pieces of knowledge. Don't do the math. Everything that I say is right and exact. If not, correct me. The truth is the way, the square of all unrighteousness. So I bring you truth. And the truth will make you mad, then make you free. So do the knowledge to my wisdom. Now, with that being said, let me go over the procedures of a lawsuit. What are the procedures? What are the procedures of a lawsuit? Today's date, according to their calendar, is March the 19th, 2012, according to their calendar. So the procedures of a lawsuit is a complaint. Someone have a flow chart here. It's a complaint. What's in a complaint? This is the first procedure of a lawsuit. The plaintiff actually clearly states all the facts that's essential to win. Nothing more. You just state the facts, nothing more. And you state the law that actually supports those facts once the facts has been proven. Then you state the vivacity of motions, or you could just say the flurry of motions. Many like to call this one the flurry of motions. I like to call it the vivacity of motions. This is actually done by the defendant. The defendant files motions to actually dismiss, to strike, or require the plaintiff to prove their complaint is legitimate. So if the defendant could actually prove that the plaintiff's complaint is not legitimate, the case is actually dismissed. They get rid of the case. So if the defendant fails to do this, you get an answer. So this is actually, if the vivacity of motion actually fails by the defendant actually must answer all the allegations that's actually stated in the plaintiff's complaint. So if you want to call this the flurry of motions, you could. I just like that word, vivacity of motions. So if, again, if the vivacity of motion fails, the defendant actually must answer all of the allegations in this complaint that's actually filed by the plaintiff. Or actually, the defendant has to admit, claim, no knowledge, or deny what this plaintiff is saying, and then state his defense if he has one. Then that takes us down to the discovery. The discovery is actually a request for the admissions or request for the productions and the interrogatories and dispositions and the court subpoenas. And the power of these facts are placed on the court's records. So that's your discovery. Which actually brings us to the trial. The trial. No, you know what the trial is. So the trial actually occurs if the defendant actually fails to get the plaintiff's case dismissed. So then it goes to trial. If he fails to get the case dismissed, it goes to trial, or the parties fail to sooner the facts by the discovery to promote the settlement. So you go to trial. So court basically starts with the exchange of documents between two or more parties. That's what court actually is. I got about 5 more minutes. Let me try to briefly summarize what I actually just went over. So lawsuits to some are very complicated. That's why I felt compelled to do this. And most don't understand it. So as you see, there are 3 main phrases in the lawsuit. This complaint, the vivacity of flurry emotions, or the answer. Actually, the main phrases, or the complaint, the answer, and the trial. I retract that first statement. Those are the 3 main phrases. The complaint, the answer, and the trial. Then you have the flurry or the vivacity of motions and the discovery. So the lawsuit is actually won by making a record of the facts of law, actually doing these 5 phrases that I actually just went over. So to win, the plaintiff, you must actually meet your burden, because the burden of proof is always on the plaintiff. You must meet your burden to prove that the facts and the controlling law in your jurisdiction agree. And the defendant, your duty is to merely prove that the plaintiff's facts and law does not agree. So the plaintiff cannot actually meet his burden of proof. So during these phases, the plaintiff tries to prove that burden of proof. Now, while the defendant has to try to shoot holes and pinpoint falsehoods, if any exist, into the plaintiff's case. And it's that simple, brothers and sisters. In all actuality, it's that simple. So you have the complaint, and the complaint, again, concisely and clearly states all the facts necessary to win, and you say nothing else. So the plaintiff also states clearly the law that support those facts. So if the stated facts are proven to be true, now he will be actually given a favorable verdict according to the law. So the power of law exists whenever necessary facts are actually proven to exist. So in order to win a lawsuit, you must prove not only that the necessary facts are true, but if those facts or true and supported by law. Is there a law that provides a court-enforced remedy for your damages resulting in these facts? That's the ultimate question. That's the $300 million question. Is there? Next, and it looks like this may actually end up turning into 2 videos, you have the vivacity of motions, or the flurry of motions. The defendant files its motions to dismiss, to strike, or to make a more definite settlement, and actually requires the plaintiff to prove his complaint, to prove that his complaint is legitimate. So this vivacity of flurry of motions is used by the defendant to get rid of the case. So if successful, the defendant doesn't have to file an answer to the plaintiff's complaint. A flurry of motions, or the vivacity of motions, can actually succeed where the plaintiff was actually in the right if the plaintiff failed to include in his complaint the sufficient facts to state a cause of action. So you have to state the sufficient facts to state a cause of actions. And actually, if the plaintiff made statements that were actually imprudent and actually scandalous, or used, for instance, poor English to make it impossible for the court to understand his case. Because many of you like to use big words when it's totally unnecessary. And I'm going to continue this on in the next video. So for now, I'm going to say shalom. Watch part 2.